This program is a compilation of extracts from a number of videos we have produced throughout the years. This poem by Leo Dunn captures the spirit of the work we do. Lusk. So much to tell about this place, one wonders where to start. We've tried to capture and preserve with DVD and art. But there's just so much history in this tiny village way to capture all its riches in a task ongoing today. The process started years ago through the foresight of a few, but now we see the fruits of this for the future and the new. We've many, many records, writings, interviews, videos and stories, you could say all the news, of a place of ancient history, of a people who are gone, of buildings now preserved in time of a very early dawn. And with the help of many friends, we've taken to this task. We will continue to uncover and the centuries past unmask.
Lusk derives its name from the Gaelic word lusca, which means cave. The area has been occupied for about 5,000 years, as this has been proved by Stone Age implements which have been found on Rogerstown estuary, where man first hunted. In addition, in Bow, a cist grave has been found, and this dates back to about almost 4,000 years.
In 1991, people of Lusk and surrounding areas visited Grace Dhu.
Did you enjoy that, Seamus?
And in 1050, in the village of Lusk, there was established a convent of nuns. We know very little, practically nothing, about that convent of nuns. What order they were attached to, or what their work was, we do not know. But what we do know is that in the year 1190, that convent of nuns was transferred from Lusk here to the ground on which we are standing. It was transferred to Grace Dhu. Now, I do not know whether that was the name of the land before the convent came here, or whether that name was put onto it after the convent was established. Now, Cumann, he was the first Norman Archbishop of Dublin, and he was also a great builder, like the rest of the Normans who had come over. In that same year, he started the foundations of St. Patrick's Cathedral in Dublin. Now, when he transferred the convent here to Grace Dhu, he endowed it with at least 12 churches which were around the area, some of them even down into Kildare. He endowed Grace Dhu with. That was money would come from the churches for the convent, for the use of this convent. And they had all those churches right up to the dissolution in 1540. Now, some of the churches, one was Lusk, St. Mary's of Lusk, the other was Portran and Donabate, and some down in Kildare, another over at Westfieldstown, a place called Westfieldstown. Now, the convent was established as a teaching school for girls of the Norman or English families within the Pale. There they were to be taught languages, etiquette, deportment, and how to behave as ladies of quality. How many would have been in the convent at any one time, I'm not known. I do not know how many would have been here. But judging by the nuns that were here when the convent was closed, there were 5 of them. So we could easily say, I suppose, maybe about 30 girls would be here at any one time.
Obtained the lands of Turvey from the Duke of Ormond. And local traditions...
The buildings were taken over at the Reformation by Sir Patrick Barnwell. And later he used the stones to build Turvey House. Is this sacred ground still haunted by the spirits of the past? This was a thriving community with a large farm orchards and a watermill, and the roads came directly to it. After centuries of neglect, very little remains standing today.
No cross, no columns mark where they dwelt. No stone with fulsome litany. Their deeds are in the archangel's scroll. No garlands seek humility. Bitter and full was their cup of grief as the final toll of their vespers bell rang, when with heavy, sad and anguished hearts they bade it their last farewell.
This is the tombstone of the last abbess, Alison White, who took her community to Portrane Castle.
Newgrange, a study in stone, 40,000 tons of stone. That's a sizable lump of Ireland, but how long is it here? Well, if you guessed 5,000 years, you wouldn't be too far out. Before Stonehenge was built in England, before the Greek civilization had settled down, before there was a pyramid in Egypt, we had a thriving old civilization here. The whole area is full of mounds, tombs, most of them. Fornox near the Nile is a very quiet little place. But look around you and you can see why Celtic forebears chose this as a place. You can see seven counties from here on a fine day. The sun is always in view from Fornox, and the sun was the important thing as far as the Celts were concerned. This tomb in the Fornox was excavated early this century. And in fact, it is the widest single-span tomb in Western Europe. This is a cold and empty place now. But can you imagine the activity here when work was in progress? Most of these elaborate tombs took not months, but years to complete. In fact, Newgrange took as much as 40 years and gave employment to hundreds of people. I suppose our government could do worse than commission a few tombs right now. Lusk was a centre, maybe the centre, of pagan worship in Fingal for about 1,000 years before Christianity was gradually established. Like now, their priests were the link between the people and the other world. Celts called them druids. Druids were fairly bright sparks, and promising chap could spend maybe 20 years preparing for a career in the religious life. At the end of that time, he'd know everything worth knowing about what was essentially a very gentle religion. There was a great belief in the sacredness of stones or anything ancient, like oak trees or white thorns. And a crowd of children was just the thing to keep away evil spirits, and at certain times of the year, particularly in the late spring, you couldn't walk a mile in this country without bumping into a mob of pure young children horsing around a standing stone or in a sacred grove, and the affair being conducted by a priest or two. This, of course, is to keep the favour of the sun god, Lu, and to let the sun shine on their animals and crops for the season. We can never be sure of times or dates before in prehistory. But about 2,000 years ago, when Christ was on earth, such was the fame of Lusk that Cú Chulainn, the hero, was attracted to it to claim his bride Emer. At this time, we are at the stage where legend is beginning to become history, and written records are emerging.
Years ago, in this square of Lusk, a declaration was made in favour of joining the revolution going on in Ireland at that time. Lusk, then being in the English Pale, Luke Netterville declared on the Royalist side on its behalf. This and other events were to lead to Cromwell's coming to Ireland 8 years later,
and the consequences of that occasion are with us this very day.
I declare on your behalf, for the Catholic Army, for God, King and country, to fight for the liberation of Ireland and the freedom of its people from English interference.
Yay!
We demand an end to the confiscation of our lands.
Yay!
And the restoration of the graces.
Yay!
Just over 200 years ago, the quiet estuary of Rogerstown was a busy place. The smuggling trade was at its height. Almost all of the population of the town of Rush and Port Bran was connected with smuggling. The goods smuggled in to avoid import duty were brandy, rum, tea, tobacco, laces, and other sundry goods. Some seizures of goods by the revenue officers was very large. On the Beaverstown side in 1780, the revenue officers seized 200 casks of brandy buried in the ground. It took 26 horses and cars to bring the brandy to the King's stores in Dublin City. On another occasion, 111 chests of tea were seized on Lambay. A seizure of run goods, smuggled goods were known as run goods, took place in Port Ram. The goods were locked up in a barn. That night up to 500 smugglers attacked the barn to retrieve the goods, but they were beaten off by the revenue officers and the crew of a naval frigate lying offshore. On another occasion, a ship named the Dispatch of Port Ram was chased by a naval frigate off the Wicklow coast. The captain and crew of the Dispatch jumped overboard, swam ashore and escaped. The Dispatch was brought to Dublin, where she was found to be laden with run goods: tobacco, tea, rum and brandy. The smuggling of goods by sea was a dangerous trade. The ships loaded the cargoes at Dunkirk in France and had to come down the English Channel and up the Irish Sea, where the British Navy and revenue cutters were always on the lookout for smugglers. In the 1790s, the smuggling trade came to an end. War had broken out between England and France, and the British Navy were on constant patrol in the English Channel for a French invasion fleet, which never came. It was no place for an honest smuggler.
Thank you. this.
Get it out there.
Into the back, lad. Into the back. Into the back. Quiet, man.
Look, what's that coming? Can you see the lights?
Let's click over. It looks like smugglers.
Smugglers from Rogerstown, right.
Right, let's go.
Hold! Who goes
there? Hold! Run, Farron!
Fire!
Fire!
With the beginning of World War II, many men emigrated to work in England. Birmingham was the most popular place and has retained its Irishness to this day. The weekly registered letter containing John Bull's money lifted many a heart in Lusk and elsewhere. In the late 50s, the job situation worsened. Again, the flight of young people overseas in search of work, taking an aching void with them and leaving one behind. The misery of the mail boat relieved only by Christmas or summer visits home. Lusk now has a population of 3,000 people. The worsening economic situation of the country from the mid-80s onwards has again produced the departure of many of our young people worldwide in search of work. At least they are now better qualified and educated to take their place anywhere in society. The mass exodus which occurred as a result of the famine in the 1840s and continues to this day has robbed us of many of the brightest and the best. There is hardly a place in the world today where descendants and emigrants from this country cannot be found.
In the last century, the Irish emigrants who lived in London, in New York, Chicago and Birmingham could rest assured that even though time was passing, the country at home remained the same. Surely, an exile could someday return and look at the old farm, the old village, the landscape of their youth. And yes, truly that was the case, because Ireland was one of the last countries in the Western world to enter into what we call globalisation. But inevitably, it arrived. And for the last decade, the rural shape of our country has been changing beyond recognition. As Ireland goes, so goes the village. And Lusk is in the midst of a very rapid and permanent change. Call it progress if you like, but nonetheless, it's sad to think that nothing will be the same again. A generation ago, in this village, Lusk people lived. Now we have several nationalities, every county of Ireland is represented, and that's not a bad thing by any means. But on the other hand, it's sad to think that old places, old names will change. So we in the Lusk Heritage Group decided that we'd show you Lusk today. Yesterday was different, so will tomorrow be.
This finished piece of bronze sculpture, organised by the Lusk Tidy Towns Committee, symbolises the coming together of the old and the new and provokes a sense of unity and welcome. Clasp hands flow into a torque-like shape, representing our Celtic past, combining with a modern welcome. The verse on the base of the stone, and written by artist historian Brendan Scally, encompasses in a few words the history of Lusk, its culture, its past, its present, and its future. Lusca, this ancient place, cradled a message. Sounds of distant bells raise echoes. New bells clamor. Listen to the old, let friendship flourish.
Well, here we are in the green in Lusk, the pivotal centre of the old village.
The new developments and housing estates of Lusk fan out from here, but this is where it all began. The unusual bandstand in front of the church was very important because of the existence of the Black Raven Pipe Band, who were started by Thomas Ashe. The Catholic Church, which is the pivot of the pivot, originally built in 1809, and it was rebuilt in 1922. It's an extremely fine building. The old school, which dates back as far as 1874, it was replaced obviously by the new school here in Lusk, and it's been home to Black Raven Pipe Band for many years now. The Carnegie Library goes back as far as 1908, when the Carnegie Trust was building libraries all around the country. Nowadays it's home to a judo club, and it's been an important part of the parish for years. Paddy Weston's house, which is well known for its pottery, but not so well known for the fact that it was once a parish house and the priest of the parish lived in it. The old pump, a relic of old decency, which is still surviving, but it's more decorative than functional at this stage.
This is to commemorate not alone the building and the changing, but the archaeological dig that was done here over the last couple of years to make us acquainted with the wealth of history that's attached to this little part of the world. Stephen Johnston and his team spent a long time up here under canvas, under cloudy skies, digging for very interesting results.
If I give this a tug.
This poem was written especially for the Lusk Heritage Group for the unveiling of the commemorative stone on the new Rathmore Road, Lusk, written by local artist Leo Dunn, entitled Buried Treasure. For most, a treasure is a find of riches such as gold or coin or precious stones that shall be mine. But buried treasure can be more, enriching knowledge of before, the past and whence we came and lived. And as we build our future way, by chance, unearth a former path, returning to that distant past of which we can but wonder. But glimpses of our origins are treasures, rare and rich, to last, recorded for a future time, when some may wonder who we were and whence they came. And so we'll mark this precious find with name and stone for future time, so others may discover that we too did come this way one time. Fingal County Council has undertaken a road widening scheme at the junction of Church Road and Treen Hill in our historic village of Lusk. The site is circa 150 metres west of and within the precinct of the early medieval monastic site. Fingal County Council therefore commissioned Archaeological Consultancy Services Limited to carry out an archaeological assessment of the site in advance of the road development. The excavation at Church Road Lusk commenced on Tuesday the 7th of June 2005. To date, 9 burials, 7 adults, 1 juvenile and 1 infant have been recorded at the site. They were all recorded very close to the existing ground surface and were all laid out along an east to west orientation with the heads located at the west. This is typical of Christian burial practice and in an archaeological context, indicative of the medieval period. The juvenile burial had a metal leaf-shaped spearhead protruding from the upper chest. The spearhead, and consequently the burial, can be dated to the early Christian period, 6th to 12th century AD. A substantial ditch was recorded at the eastern side of the site. A rectangular souterrain chamber was recorded towards the centre of the site. This was aligned northwest to southeast and was stone-lined on two sides. The floor of the chamber consisted of a metalled surface. The chamber dates to the early Christian period, but was block-filled in the medieval period as numerous sherds of pottery dating to the 13th to 14th century were collected from it. Site works are still ongoing to date.
Fingal has got a long history behind it, and I have to say, in that history, Lusk, if I was to pick a place that is identified with Fingal, it is Lusk. See, Lusk has been the heart of Fingal, and as such, I think it is a very appropriate that this unveiling takes place here.
Raven, oh Raven, what is it you say? How are you here? Why did you stay? These people, this place, have cast you in stone, have given you status, made you a throne. Raven, black raven, I suspect it may be that you watch and you warn when danger you see. Whatever the reason, you're coming our way, may be lost to the past, but belong here today. O raven, black raven, long may you stay.
This year marks the 90th anniversary of the uprising in 1916, a pivotal period in our history. 10 years ago, we set up an exhibition in Lusk, which recorded Lusk and its activities or its connections with 1916. It was a really enjoyable and well-attended function, and it was contributed to by an awful lot of people who had still got strong memories of 1916 and its aftermath. So we've some images that we recorded at the time which I think are interesting.
You're all very good to come to support us in this exhibition, and I welcome also the Cathaoirleach of Fingal County Council, the Chairman David Byrne, and the fellow councillors of the area. The exhibition, of course, as you probably have all seen, is a commemoration of the 80th anniversary of the 1916 rising. And here we are in the very centre of the Fingal nucleus, if you like, of the revolution. The man who figures most prominently in the story in this area, of course, is Thomas Ashe. He came in 1908 as a teacher to Cutoff National School, one of the outlying schools of the parish of Lusk. And in Easter week, 80 years ago, the 28th of April, these heroic men, roughly 80 of them, set out Tom Ashe to carry out the rebellion in this part of the country. After attacking many police barracks on the Friday, they attacked the one at Ashbourne. And unknown to themselves, it turned into a fairly big battle that lasted roughly 5 hours. However, it was the one decisive victory of the whole Easter week. uprising.
A year later, we recorded the death of Thomas Ashe. Thomas Ashe, who taught in Cardiff National School and who died in 1917. At the time, in 1997, we planted a tree in memory of Thomas Ashe in the grounds of Round Towers, an organisation which had direct connections or direct links with Thomas Ashe. So again, we have the images of that time, and again, I'd just like to let them speak for themselves.
I should like to thank everybody, and I can say from the people of Dingle who had a commemoration like this some weeks back, that they were delighted to hear that there was something similar being done here by the local community. And I'd like to thank the local community and the councillors for their interest in it. And I will now attempt to plant the tree in a way that will not cause a difficulty in the future. I just feel myself that there is nothing more appropriate to Thomas Ashe than the fact of putting something living there, because he himself had a great interest in the whole area of nature study. The next bit. But I think that's a very fitting and a beautiful stone, and I really would like to say to young people as well, and say a few words inside, about the importance of remembering people like this. I really like to say to young people in particular that, you know, when we look back in history, we wonder what's it all about. And I know I'd be the first to say that when I was growing up in Dingle, we thought it was more important that Thomas Ashe was related to Gregory Peck than I was a bit older before I figured out the real importance of his life. And I suppose I'm conscious then that people come to terms with things as they get older. But I myself, as Thomas Ashe, I'm General Secretary of the INTO, and Thomas Ashe's family were very involved in the INTO for many, many years. He himself was involved with our Dublin branch. He was a tremendous teacher and educator, and that's the first thing I want to say about him. He's not perhaps remembered as much about that as we would like. He was an extraordinary educator. He took an interest in children with special needs at a time when most people felt they should be kept at home. He was a person who was prize-winning a teacher teaching in this fold in his own area before he came up here.
The archaeological excavation dig at Dunema Lusk began on the 26th of September 2005. The stripping of an area 200 metres by 120 metres revealed a settlement of the early Christian period. This included a surrounding ditch with a bridge in access. The excavation uncovered evidence of settlement in cooking, wastage and storage remains. Surprisingly, the settlement was on land which had field outlines from an earlier period. The lack of artifacts poses a question as to the ending of the settlement and the need for taking everything in a speedy leave-taking. This artistic impression serves to help the imagination. Would it be unreasonable to consider that the settlement had a connection with the time of St. McCollum? Prior to this time, there hadn't been any archaeological investigation of any significance in the Lusk area. The settlement of the new community has, therefore, indirectly informed us of our distant past.
It's time I stopped talking to the locals at this stage. We know where everything is in this town. I want to talk to our new citizens. People who have moved into their new houses. You've got plenty to do at the moment, but when you have a little bit of free time, we want you to go out there and have a look at the clubs and societies in the village. We have a tremendous infrastructure of clubs, and we've had them for years. First thing you're going to need when you get out there, let's hope, is your residence association. And after that, why not take out your golf clubs, have a little bit of a swing, relax. Life is not all about paying mortgages. Maybe, if you're feeling particularly athletic, you could go and join the Badminton Society. And then maybe when smaller members of the family arrive, how about the Cubs, the Beavers, the Scouts, and push them on up there, teach them to dance. Three Irish dancing schools. The folk group is out there waiting to catch up all the sweet voices that are moving into this particular town. If things are not working out great for you, I'll have to say, bring that aggression down to the judo club. Lusk's aggression has paid dividends in judo society down the years. And then, of course, tidy towns. Pat Kelly always wants a fresh victim to get out there and help Lusk maintain its position in County Dublin's tidy towns and villages awards. The Photographic Society is always there. There's plenty to picture in the long summer days in Lusk on the Costa del Quickpenny Road. Apart from that, we want volunteers as well for the Senior Citizens Club. We want them for all the other voluntary organisations. The ICA is always out there. You don't have to be a farmer to be a member of the ICA. Just get out there. We want to see you people joining in.
The Heritage Group goes back 1989, Pat.
Yeah.
It's going from strength to strength. It grew out of a little organisation called the All Fine Gael Society. The All Fine Gael Society more or less broke up into individual local groups after that. And Pat Kelly here beside me was naturally the engine that drove the Lusk Heritage Group and has continued to drive it very, very successfully in the meantime. We've made numerous videos. We've sponsored a couple of books. We're always wide awake to the sort of heritage we have.
Well, I had great respect for Willie Monks. Willie Monks was the local historian, and Willie had a wealth of information. And when Willie passed on, there was nothing here to record what should be recorded as regards interviewing our senior citizens and recording things for the future. And I just felt it was very important that a group got together, and I was very lucky in getting Jim, Monks, Aidan, Arnold, Paddy Weston, and we decided to do our first videos, The Story of Lusk, which we interviewed a lot of our senior citizens, and they gave them their memories of times past. And we've done lots of things since that, not only videos, but we did the restoration of the Eklund tomb. We've done exhibition to Thomas Ashe, where we planted a tree and a plaque in the local GAA. We also have done a leaflet for tourists, and we're going from strength to strength, as Jim says. Mm.
2006, another film done, and at this stage 2006 has passed it. The longest day has come and gone, another year consigned to the past. Out there, though, is tomorrow, next week, next year, the whole future. And believe me, that future will bring change the same as the past has done. The Heritage Group has over many years sketched, shown the story of this place from the very mists of history, right up to T-O-D-A-Y. At this stage, I think our work is nearly done, because this last series of films has shown Lusk in transition, Lusk in change. Our laid-back little village, which hadn't changed, let's face it, in over 100 years, has been pulled and pushed and developed right up to the present. It's one of the fastest growing towns in the fastest growing county in the fastest growing country in Europe. It's real, folks. It's happening. For better or for worse, like it or lump it, this town is changing forever. We can't regret it. We have recorded it. And thank God we have so many citizens still who can recall those good old, bad old days. But now, I think the only way to move with this change is to listen to the song. You've got to roll with it. Yes, Lusk people, congratulations. You are rolling with it. Plenty of you are doing just that. Through the clubs and the societies who have their roots in the long ago, the past, the present, the new and the old will unite. I'm being serious here. It's not going to be a bed of roses. Every town has had its share of problems as it develops. But in this case, I'm quite sure that every gathering and every group, every sport and every society will smooth the way and will assist this new place to find its place. I can only say with a fair degree of certainty that in 20 years or 40 years, no matter how big this town is, everybody who lives here will say, I'm a Lusk person.